Good morning. Welcome to our city commission meeting. We'll open with a prayer with Pastor Dr. Jeremy Pridgen, and then followed by the pledge led by General McQueen. Please rise.
Let us pray. Lord, 3 years ago today, a reality was setting in that life had changed in our community. And we pause today mindful of the ways that you have led us from the paths of rubble and destruction and in the aftermath of a storm to steps of progress on a journey that continues today as we seek to rebuild and recover from the effects of Hurricane Michael. We give you thanks for the leadership that was demonstrated in those difficult days that continues to guide us as a people, that as you have done through the ages, you are doing now, leading us from the wilderness into a promised land. So we claim that hope as ours this morning, even as this commission gathers to take the next steps that will help us to see the dreams that we have become a reality. We thank you for Panama City. We thank you for its citizens. We pray that you would continue to keep her in your care, and may the things we do enable all to experience life and liberty and the pursuit of happiness as we continue to seek you in all that we do. We pray these things in Christ's name. Amen.
Amen.
Please join me in the pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Jim, would you call the roll, please, ma'am?
Commissioner Halagus?
Here.
Commissioner Brown?
Here.
Commissioner Rader?
Here.
Commissioner Street?
Here.
Mayor Budnicki?
Here.
You have quorum, Mayor.
Thanks. We have the minutes from our September 27th meeting. Everyone had a chance to read those minutes. Any comments, changes, something that's not there that should be there? If so, say at this time, otherwise entertain a motion to approve as they are presented.
Mr. Mayor, I have looked them over pretty good, and I didn't see anything that was really wrong, so I made some notes just from my records to keep, because I like to keep the minutes. So I'd like to move approval of the minutes from the commission meeting on September 27th.
Second the motion, Mayor.
Call the roll.
Commissioner Halagus?
Yes.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Street?
Yes.
Mayor Budnicki?
Yes.
Motion passes 5-0.
We have some community announcements. You need to join us at City Hall on October 29th for a spooktacularly scary good time as the City of Panama City Quality of Life Department presents A Haunting at the Hall. This haunted story time experience features local tale narrators, based storytellers, weaving a hauntingly spooky tale sure to amuse and fright. October 30th, pack up your goblins, ghouls, and ghosts and head downtown to Panama City for some Halloween family fun. Saturday, October 30th, after the fall festival, come grab some treats, maybe a few tricks at the Quality of Life Trunk or Treat. Trunk or Treat runs from 4 to 7 p.m. November 3rd, bring your lunch to City Hall on the first Wednesday of every month from November to April, weather permitting, and relax to the smooth sounds of the Panama City Symphony Orchestra as we present the Symphony in the City. This inaugural free event starts at 12:12 p.m. on November 3rd in the Panama City Hall Rotunda, at the Panama City Hall Rotunda.
That'd be great.
Okay. Sergeant Eric Beatty here? And his entourage. Bring your family down, please.
Who's guarding the station? Just asking, I mean, you know.
Sergeant Eric Beatty, badge number 2401, started his career with the Panama City Police Department on October 2nd, 2001. During his tenure with the Panama City Police, Sergeant Beatty has worked in patrol services, investigations, and the Special Operations Unit. Throughout Sergeant Beatty's career, he has received 5 life-saving awards and 2 medals of distinction. He is further recognized for his enthusiastic can-do attitude. He holds the respect of the officers he mentors and leads, as well as the supervisors and staff he teams with. It is with great honor and respect that we award Sergeant Eric Beatty his 20-year service award from the City of Panama City.
I was gonna make fun of Josh for it. The font's bigger. I mean, I said, who did that? But it was Billy. Okay. That's good stuff. Hey, Billy. Nothing, Josh. That's good.
That was awesome.
Okay, consideration to set our second November City Commission meeting to November 30th instead of 2 days before Thanksgiving. So how does that work with everybody? I mean, it's kind of that particular week.
We're going to accept that, and we're going to do it the following Tuesday, right?
Yes, going to do it the following Tuesday because it's rather than having it 2 days.
In other words, it'll be after Black Friday and after Thanksgiving week.
There you go.
I already told the staff I'm fine with it.
All right, we got a motion.
Yes.
Second motion, Mayor.
Call the roll.
Commissioner Halagus?
Yes.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Street?
Yes.
Mayor Budnicki?
Yes.
Motion passes 5-0.
Okay, because of Christmas in December, there is, the last many, many years, we've always had one meeting in December because the second Tuesday is usually a day or two before Christmas. So I want to bring up today the consideration to have our City Commission meeting on December 14th, which is the midpoint of the month. I want to make sure everybody's
not that
okay.
I seem so excited about not having meetings, but I'll move a motion to accept that, okay. to only have one meeting in December.
The 14th, I'll second that motion.
Okay. Call the roll.
Commissioner Halagus?
Yes.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Street?
Yes.
Mayor Bernicki?
Yes.
Motion passes 5-0.
Okay. Jan, would you list our office, people that are, want to come up and speak today in audience participation?
Good morning. The mayor has opened the meeting to public comment. When your name is called, you'll have three, please come and state your name and your address for the record, and you'll have 3 minutes to speak. Our first speaker is Virginia Nunley.
Good morning. I have two things I'd like to talk about. The first one is the voluntary buyout program for the flooding that's happened in the area that I live in, and I'm sure all of Panama City. I have a list of concerns here. What I would like to do is to submit.
Hold on one second. Isn't that on the agenda today?
Yes.
Okay, it's on our agenda today, so if you want to address us at that particular time,
okay,
we're going to bring it up.
Okay.
I think you just wanted to drop those off.
Maybe. Okay, well, if you want to give us that ahead of time,
okay,
that's fine.
But the other one, that the other concern that I really have is the increase in the water bill. I'm not very smart, but I don't understand why the water bill has to go up so much, 7% over a year, and that if they just took the garbage pickup of twice a week and made that once a week, and the people that need it twice a week, give them an extra garbage can, let them pay a nominal fee for it, that we couldn't keep our water bill, our water usage or bill at the same price that we're paying now.
Okay.
That's it.
Thank you. Okay. We'll bring up the other issue when we get to it on the agenda.
Okay. Ms. Nunley, if you don't mind, just if you could hand that to Doreen right over there at the very end.
Okay.
She'll be glad to receive that from you, and we appreciate that. Thank you.
Thank you.
The second speaker is Bill DeMuy.
Good morning. Thank you all for letting me speak today. I live at 1841 Lake Avenue. I'm in this area of the home buyout program. And I know you can't do nothing about the flooding, and y'all are working on it, and I appreciate that. But what my concern is, this last rain we had vehicles driving down our roads, pushing water in people's houses. Mm. I seen city dump trucks. I seen county school buses. I seen post office people driving down these flooded roads. People's houses who ain't flooded, and just about an inch from being flooded, they got flooded because of that. I talked with Commissioner Street, and he's wanting to bring up something about no wake zone or something, but we got to have somebody there to enforce it. You know, we had barricades up and people driving around. And that's just my concern. And hopefully the next rain we come, we won't be there, or I won't be there, or whatever. But in the meantime, we know what happens when we get a big rain. And I'd just like to see if y'all could address that, because, I mean, the dump truck that went down 19th Street, the poor people who live at Cincinnati and, Lake, I'm sure they got a lot of it. But it's just frustrating that we do everything we can to try to protect our houses, and then we've got vehicles, county vehicles, city vehicles coming down our roads, and no disregard for the people. I mean, I can understand creeping down a road, no wake, but this was above and beyond what should have been done. And I'd like to see some kind of action or talk about it or discuss it or something, but I mean, those people there are hurting. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
I think it's one of those situations that we just need to, from now on that happens, close the road until it.
Well, I think it was, but people
drove around it.
Maybe a stronger barricade.
Yeah, it's a situation. I think there's part of it that people don't understand what they're doing to other people.
Sure.
And then there's another part of it that just some people just don't care.
Well, and I never thought about it till you made that post that you're like, be careful going down because you're pushing water.
Yeah, it really happens.
I have never even thought about that till you posted that. So if there's a way to completely close it or put barricades stronger than they were or whatever, I don't know.
I sent over to Nevin an example of a no-wake ordinance that's in several cities. So I'm sure he'll do some research on that and see if there's something we can't do. But at that point, then it becomes something that PCPD, not that they're looking for anything else to do. but they could actually ticket, you know, with that. So, you know, I mean, at the biggest point, it's education. So when you got a flooded street, go around it or go incredibly slow through it.
That was the last speaker, Mayor.
Okay.
There's
Nevin?
One more. He just came up and talked to
me. Okay. Tony Bostick?
Mm-hmm. Excuse me.
Tony, excuse me. Tony Bostick, 159 North Kimball Avenue. Good morning, Mr. Mayor and Commissioners. You often ask why I seem to stay after you guys. Well, the following are just a few of the reasons. Number one, you constantly misrepresent the truth. Some read this as outright lying. When it comes to answers sought by the African-American community as it relates to the recovery and investment in our community. Number two, other than the Quality of Life Department, there appears to be no other department within the city that is willing to work with the minority community. Mr. De Palma has really extended the olive branch time and time again, yet that same willingness does not appear to exist within other city organizations. Thank you, Mr. De Palma. You have a monthly meeting, number three, you have a monthly meeting with local minority pastors, and when they inquired about the possibility of hiring a minority fire chief, what did you do? You gave the excuse that you couldn't find qualified candidates or that none applied, and selected a white male who had been trained by the interim fire chief who happened to be an African American. Now please explain that move. You say you want to be the premier city in the Panhandle, yet your track record of leadership diversity demonstrates the opposite. Of 15 departments within the city, you have 9 white male, 7 white female, 1 black male, and 1 Hispanic male department head. And in the 3 city management positions, the city manager and 2 assistant managers, you have 2 white males and 1 white female. Your premier city vision appears to be a return to the premier city of the antebellum era, as opposed to the premier city of the future. Now, we won't discuss the inequality in the supervisory positions within these departments because that would be even more disturbing. Does this sound like you're trying to be the best? I say not. Concerning Thursday's situation at Hillside Cemetery, Mr. Mayor, you may want to recheck the Florida statutes before you saddle up and make blanket statements to the media as to the legality of your actions, specifically Florida statutes 497 and 872. Since you did, in fact, have the authority to act and chose to take a different path, and one of your supporters and fellow laymen in the profession was in misdemeanor violation of at least 2 Florida statutes. And lastly, but certainly not least, your lack of empathy or sympathy in the presence of several crying individuals who had loved ones interred in Hillside, you did not even speak to them in order to show any sort of compassion to alleviate their hurt or comfort them. Once again, demonstrated your apathy, as has been mentioned to you in past commission meetings. It's simple. If you don't care, just say it. You don't have to lie or justify. Thank you.
Marshall Clay.
Michelle.
Oh, my apologies, Michelle.
Talk about lying. That's all I'm going to say.
Michelle Clay, 803 East 10th Street. I know you guys have heard a lot of positive, negative, but I just have to give a huge shout out to Shonda Palmer and the Quality of Life, kind of piggybacking off of what Tony just shared. They are one of the best willing partners that you have. I don't know if you could create a framework for other departments to follow with this department. On Thursday, we started our very first senior living program, and where I lived, my whole subdivision was completely flooded. We couldn't get out for hours. And I called David specifically from the Quality of Life Department, who lived nearby, and he made a point to get there, get orange juice, get donuts, just in case people showed up. And surprisingly, many seniors showed up. Which was touching for me because, you know, they don't need to be out driving, you know, with the flooded roads, but because of this program, they decided to come out. Commissioner Brown came out, and I know many of you were trying to figure out what was going on with the city, but I just want to definitely give a shout out to his department and specifically David for coming out and making sure our seniors were welcome for those that came out. So thank you guys.
That's amazing. Michelle, thank you for doing that.
Mayor, that's the last speaker, for real.
Okay, Nevin?
Thank you. The first item I have is, it's item 6A, if you look at that in your packet. The 6A is a ratification of extensions to declaration of state of emergency for tropical storm Fred. I believe that these are the last three that we'll have. It's extension 7, 8, and 9.
Your motion?
Move approval, Mayor.
Second motion, Mayor.
Discussion? Call roll.
Commissioner Halagus?
Yes.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Street?
Yes.
Mayor Bernicki?
Yes.
Motion passes 5-0.
The next item is...
Are you going to read it?
Was it a...
Do you need to read it?
No.
You don't need to read it?
I don't need to read it. It's not a resolution.
Okay.
The next item is a ratification of a local state of emergency that was declared by the mayor. And this is a resolution, and because it's the first one. And this is due to the rainfall event that occurred on October 7th, 2021. And there's the justification in that. And this is being declared in the event that the city could qualify for FEMA funding. So the request is to ratify Resolution 20-211-007.1 declaring a state of emergency for flooding.
Your motion?
So moved, Mayor.
Second.
Discussion? Call the roll.
Commissioner Halagus?
Yes.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes, ma'am.
Commissioner Street?
Yes.
Mayor Bernicki?
Yes.
Motion passes 5-0.
And I will read Resolution 20-211-007.1. A resolution and proclamation of the City of Panama City, Florida, proclaiming the existence of a state of emergency regarding the widespread flooding in the area. And that's all that I have, Mayor.
Okay. Mr. McQueen?
Mr. Mayor and Commissioners, I draw your attention to item 7, which is unfinished business, and it's 7A and 7B and 7C, and I'm requesting that the developers are continuing to move forward on making sure that everything is suitable for entry into the city. And with that in mind, it's not yet ready for action. As a result, I'm requesting that it be delayed until the 30th of November meeting, that we would readdress it at that point.
Okay. Motion to delay 7A, B, and C.
Move approval, Mayor. I'm sorry. Mr. Brown, Commissioner Brown, you go ahead and make the motion.
Any discussion? Call the roll.
Commissioner Halagus?
Yes.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Street?
Yes.
Mayor Bernicki?
Yes.
Motion passes to delay the three items, 7A, 7B, 7C, to November 30th.
Okay, we have two things on the consent agenda. Would the commission like to address either one of those separately? If not, entertain a motion to approve the consent agenda as presented.
Motion to approve, Mayor.
I'll second.
Discussion? Call the roll.
Commissioner Halagus?
Yes.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Street?
Yes.
Mayor Bernicki?
Yes.
Motion passes 5-0.
Mr. Mayor and Commissioners, item 9A is the consideration of the Voluntary Home Buyout Program subrecipient agreement. As you know, as background information, in January of 2021, the City of Panama City received the notice from the state of Florida of the intent to award the letter from the Department of Economic Opportunity approving $5 million in funding for the Voluntary Home Buyout Program. The purpose of the Voluntary Home Buyout Program is to acquire properties impacted by Hurricane Michael that are high-risk flood areas and to assist property owners in relocating outside of the threatening of future flood. As such, properties purchased under this program will be converted into open space, recreational, or floodplain and wetland use in perpetuity to reduce the impact of the future disasters. This action is necessary so that we can continue to move forward with the execution of those dollars in support of our citizens. With that, I recommend that we accept the terms associated from the Department of Economic Opportunity with regard to the Voluntary Home Buyout Program.
Would you like to come up and address this
now
about your...
Now we can talk about that.
Yeah. Now? Yes, ma'am.
I've lived on Cincinnati Avenue for 30 years. I am the longest resident on that street.
Wow.
And this is either the fourth or the fifth flood. It's my fourth. I was gone for one of the floods. And some of the things that the neighbors and I are concerned about, I don't have my glasses, is one of the things is when the appraisals are done, and I believe that there is something about EPA or somebody has to come and test the soil and make sure that there's no asbestos or anything about around like that. After that's done, how long is it going to be before we're told how much our house is worth and how much we're going to get? How long are we going to have after you all, the city, the state, whoever, hands us a check to get out of our place? The one of the other things was that will our houses be valued at today's dollars instead of pre-Michael money, which was considerably lower than what it is today. I spent yesterday 3 hours driving around town, and what I paid for my house in 1998 and what I could buy today for that would be less than a mobile home that is falling apart. So, you know, and I've looked at over 100 homes in the area, and what I could sell my house for on the market today would hardly buy a new home. So, you know, a lot of us are being uprooted from living in a house for a long time. This was going to be my retirement home, my forever home. Another question that I had that you might think would be interesting is the two questions, actually. The longevity credit that you get for your property taxes. In my case, I've lived there all of this time, and I understand that next year I would be eligible for a longevity discount on my property taxes. So if I move from here to there, will I still be eligible for the longevity tax? Because essentially, I'm moving against my own will, you know. But last week, the flood of last week, I was going to stay there before, but the flood of last week, gone. If I could move tomorrow, I'd be gone. And just like my neighbor over there, we asked in 2013, we asked for barricades for the street, and we've never gotten them yet. So the rest of it is all here, you know.
All right, we have a copy of all that?
Yes, it's got all my questions.
Some of those, you can go ahead and be seated. We could probably answer a couple of the questions, and some of them we probably can't, but I can tell you from an appraisal standpoint, it'll be at today's value.
It will be.
And when they do, we'll make sure when they do appraise the property that you're not penalized for the fact that it floods there. Because, you know, that's one of the reasons you have to move. So
that's right.
That's just common sense. Time frame?
Yeah, so we're working through this. Oh, go ahead.
Okay. Is there any noise? I'm sorry.
Well, can't we answer the question first?
Okay. Sure. So with regard to the voluntary home buyout program, it is post-Michael. It'll be current valuations on the appraisal. And in fact, the next item on the agenda is actually the contract with the appraisers to begin that action. As you alluded to separately, we will be we're having to do a request for a proposal for the services to do the environmental and hazard assessment for the property with regard to, as you mentioned, asbestos or lead-based paint or other things that have to be addressed before the properties can be completed through the voluntary home buyout program. Once all those documents are collected, we'll submit them for the state for approval. I don't know that timeline. I wish I did. I have to tell you, I'm a little surprised that it's taken this long for us to get the subrecipient agreement. It was announced back in January, and here we are in October, and we just got it last week. So it's I can't make a commitment on Department of Economic Opportunity and the speed at which they will do it, but I can share with you that the lady right in front of you is working, Jennifer Aldridge. She works this issue tirelessly on behalf of all of our citizens. With regard to the longevity tax, that's a great question also, and I look forward to going and talking to the tax collector to see how that impacts your question in the particular case that you raised. I appreciate that. Thank you.
We work together, and we want it where we don't have 3 inches or 4 inches of water in our house anymore.
Yes,
thank you, ma'am.
Absolutely. 2 days away from having a place totally finished until last week.
Oh, wow. Mm-hmm.
To add to what Ms. Ginger's saying, so she's actually one of the higher ones on the neighborhood. We've got, it's been an incredibly complex process. I know Jennifer and Nathan both have been working on it tirelessly. We've got people since Hurricane Michael that have flooded 6 to 7 times. Mm-hmm. And so there's claims that are associated with those. There's a lot of complex pieces to this specific program. DO did respond to us going to market rate, which was fantastic. But with that, it also limited the area that we're able to cover. So we've concentrated on Lake and Cincinnati, but there's still more. I mean, there's still more beyond this that we had to cut out the program. I was talking yesterday with a lady that got cut out of the program because we just didn't have enough money to do it. And so anyway, I just wanted to say, Jennifer and the Haggerty team, as well as Mr. McQueen, they really are truly doing everything that they can. Ms. Ginger is a very smart lady. So these questions that she's got are very good ones. And so I've seen some of them. I haven't been able to answer all of them. But if we could get something together, Mark, that we can get the community address, that would be fantastic.
Sure.
Thank you guys for coming.
Go ahead, Mr. Henry.
Walter P. Henry, 614 Mayberry Avenue, Panama City, Florida. We give honor to our commissioners, our mayor. What you're doing, I believe, is wonderful. It's a good idea. If nothing can be done. I don't know if anyone did engineer work, anybody game out, look at all of these properties. See, is there any way you could get rid of this water with a drain pipe? You don't have, it's too low, your ground is really too low to get it drained off. If you had to build the street up to make a difference, mm-hmm. I meant to keep the water from building up. Build the land up, build the houses up, get them off the ground. Now, mostly what some of these houses have been built built on the ground, and there's no way, they're on level ground. No way they can get this water to push in from their property into the street. And then if you got it in the street, it's holding up. If anybody looked at it when it's drown, when it's doing all this bad rain, investigate, see how could we get this water off of people's. I could speak for my street where I live. My house is 30 inches behind my ground level. I did that because we don't have, there's no way, that it is a way you can get the water out of my street, but somebody had to give you an easement to get it flowing down there between two properties to get it out of my street. And I'm just saying this thing that you could look at, that you can do, and folks might not have to move. Y'all can't pay them what their houses is worth. Then they done paid their houses off. Now they starting over again with another house payment. So, but we just want to bring this to you that somebody, not just sit down and make a decision that this is what, it's no way. See, it's a way, because it can be a way that it can be done. I know y'all put that thing out in 19th Street years ago when I was working, pumped the water out of these streets where y'all talking about now. That did not work for you. Must not have worked for you because it's still having the problems.
Thank you, Mr. Henry.
Thank you, Mr. Henry.
Okay. have the have a motion on the sub?
I'll make the motion happily.
Is there a second?
I'll second that motion.
All right, call the roll.
Commissioner Halagus?
Yes.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Street?
Yes.
Mayor Bernicki?
Yes.
Motion passes 5-0.
Good morning, Mayor.
Good morning.
Are we still at item number five, audience participation?
No, yes, we've already passed that. We're on nine.
Okay.
9B.
Well, then I need to speak with Mr. McQueen.
Okay, you can talk to him after the meeting. Thank you.
And I need to bring this up while I'm here. I almost killed myself the night of the treasurer's meeting at A.D. Harris. I thought the meeting was at A.D. Harris.
Okay.
And coming out of that cafeteria, I stepped in a hole, broke my wrist, fractured 6 ribs, fractured this right wrist, fractured my knee and my ankle.
Okay, Mr. Coleman, we'll talk to you after the meeting.
So,
I'm sorry.
Sorry to hear that.
Y'all need to do something about that hole.
All right. Sorry. Okay, 9B.
Okay. Item 9B is consideration of the contract award to Coastal Group for the residential appraisal services supporting the voluntary home buyout program. As I mentioned earlier, in January 2021, the City of Panama City received the intent of award from the Department of Economic Opportunity approving $5 million in the funding for the voluntary home buyout program. As you know, this program requires a current fair market value appraisal to be obtained for all of the participating homes. The city has received two quotes, Coastal Group at $500 per property and the Giles Appraisal Group at $1,800 per property. With that in mind, the staff recommends the approval of the Coastal Group at $500 per property for the appraisal services supporting the voluntary home buyout program.
Your motion?
Yes, I'd like to move approval of item 9B to award the contract to Coastal Group for the residential appraisal services.
Your second?
I'll second.
Discussion? Call roll.
Commissioner Halagus?
Yes.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Street?
Yes.
Mayor Bernicki?
Yes.
Motion passes 5-0.
Item 9C is the presentation of the Flood Mitigation Assistance Grant Program. I'm going to be inviting Ms. Jennifer Aldridge up to the podium. With that in mind, this is a FEMA program. We have a very short time frame with regard to doing this. It's the same program that's also being extended through Bay County to the unincorporated in our sister cities. Ms. Aldridge.
Good morning. To address Ms. Nunley and Mr. DeMay, just so you know, once the agreement is signed by both parties, we will be having a kickoff meeting for all y'all, and you can answer all these. We can hopefully answer all these questions for you. Good morning. Yes, so here we are talking about the Flood Mitigation Assistance Program. It's very similar to the Voluntary Home Buyout, but it's also offered a little bit more than just buyout. But this program is for, of course, like the Voluntary Home Buyout, repetitive flooding properties, residential, and this is also for non-residential. It could be for commercial as well. This grant provides up to 75 to 100% grant money. The 100% is mostly for if you're in the category of severe repetitive loss, so that's mostly like 4 or more times in the last 10 years with up to $20,000 worth of claims. So this mitigation program can do buyout, the structured demolition and reconstruction of your home to elevate to the proper to the current code standards, or even higher. I always recommend higher than the current code, which is 1 foot above the base flood elevation. So higher the better. Structure elevation, like I just said, a structure relocation. We can actually move the home to a different property, or if your property is big enough and have a higher point in your property, we can move it to that higher point. And for the commercial properties, this can offer dry flood proofing for commercial properties and also historical residential structures, which we do have a few of those. I don't know if any of them flood, but we do have a few. Like I said, these are for repetitive loss or severe repetitive loss. They have to be also under the National Flood Insurance Program, the NFIP, which the property owner that has an flood insurance should have that document with the FEMA information that they are part of the National Flood Insurance Program. So this does not qualify if you have private flood insurance. And this, and you also have to maintain the NFIP throughout this program as well. For more information on this program, you can contact myself, and the information is also on the city's website. The interest form is on the city's website, and we can send that to me by October 22nd. I know that's next week, but due to all the flooding, it's a very short interest form, and you can submit it right away. So,
Jennifer, thank you so much for all you're doing to help. There's people all over the city, and I've talked. Well, for example, when I go to my pharmacist, there's a young lady that she's been speaking with you and Michael and Sheila about, you know, about getting assistance. And you know her if you heard her. But anyway, people do need to understand that this there is a deadline with this program. This is separate than what we've been talking about.
Right.
This is a different deal. But just keep, take note, folks, that this is October 22, which is coming up mighty quick. And that's the lady to see right there.
And this program comes obviously every year too. So this, if you don't get it in time for this year, we'll do it again next year.
Jennifer, some of the people that have, you know, that experienced either Hurricane Michael or Hurricane Sally, they abandoned their homes and they moved. In their case, some of them didn't keep their flood insurance even though they had had it for 10 years or more before that. What would be your recommendation for people that are in that particular situation? Do they need to go ahead and get flood insurance again and then go in for next year? Or is there any look back that shows repetitive loss? Like, I mean, these are severe ones. These are not ones that have just been once or twice. It's like six, seven times.
Well, I also do, that's interesting. I would definitely say fill out the interest form. We can talk about it, because that property could be in a my repetitive loss list that I have, and I can tell the whoever the owner is at the time, I can tell them if they were, and they could possibly be eligible to apply, but that's something that the Haggerty team and I would have to discuss.
So we could advocate, I guess, mm-hmm. that even if they didn't have flood insurance right now, we could advocate for them if they've been in a severe case to potentially be in the program.
Well, and the property, it, like I said, it could be a repetitive loss. They could not have the property before, and it could be a repetitive property and mm-hmm. might not have flooded since the time they bought it, they still might be eligible for this program because the property itself does flood.
That's good to know. Okay, thank you so much.
So I think that underscores a significant point when we talk about flood insurance. The National Flood Insurance Program is available to all properties, and clearly our current flood zone maps are reflective of historical conditions. Those conditions have significantly changed with the loss of all of the trees that we have. And as a result of the loss of the trees, we don't have the absorption capacity that we once had for our water table. Our water table now is higher than it's ever been before, which means we cannot, the ground cannot absorb as much rainwater. And as a result, there's more rainwater that has to be managed through the ditches that were never designed for that capacity and volume of water. And so I think Mr. Street has spoken a few times about this, and that is the fact that if you're not in a required flood zone space to require you to have insurance, it's relatively inexpensive. It's $200-$400 a year to protect arguably our most people's most valuable asset, which is their home. And that would make you not only protected from rising waters, but also makes you eligible for programs such as what Ms. Aldridge is talking about now, especially if you have multiple losses. So we're encouraging all of our citizens to continue to explore ways to insure their properties, and the National Flood Insurance Program is one way to do that. And it helps to give you a blanket of coverage for what we're experiencing. Obviously, we've had historic rainfalls this year, who knows what will come in the days, weeks, months, and even years ahead. But it could be a very prudent measure to be able to help mitigate what's taking place. It's going to take a long time for the trees to be recovered. It's going to take a long time for the storm drains to be replaced. We're still waiting for the DEM to award the Hazard Mitigation Grant Program for the Robinson Bayou stormwater basin. We also have, and we're working on what's taking place in the southern half of the city with regard to stormwater ditch systems and a comprehensive flood analysis for our storm drain system. So it takes time, it takes engineering, it takes resources, and in the interim, there's a multiple steps that our citizens can do, which includes exploring the opportunity with the National Flood Insurance Program.
I'd like to add, so yesterday I got to sit down with Johnny and his team and just go over what happened last week. So we had the St. Andrews treatment plant, we typically have 4 million gallons of treatment. Mm-hmm. Last week, it peaked at 11 million gallons of treatment. That was stormwater that went into.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
So once we fix our sewer system, that 7 million gallons is going to go someplace. And so so in some ways, our broken system actually helped with the flooding perspective, ironically. You know, it's obviously something that's going to continue. We're going to be dealing with this for a long time. So we're, you know, seeing agenda items like this where we got three different programs, three different action steps and things like that. I mean, I told Mark when it came up on Friday, I said, you could not have a better time for us to take action on some stuff because there's a lot of people that need our help. Mm-hmm. So, Jennifer, you got job security.
Yeah.
So,
we're blessed to have you. So.
Go ahead.
I have a quick question. I'd like
to get your name and address.
Thank you for allowing me to speak. My question is in reference to that, will the city take advantage of properties that they have purchased this particular funding to develop their property? Because some of the city's property joining private property that is flooding out. So could you take advantage of some of these fundings and develop your properties that you used or use your nonprofit and use it in another? You know, I'm just trying to think out the box because, question, I have my private property, but the city has their property next door to mine, which floods and intrudes my property. So I'm wondering, how would that work?
It's going to give us another park to maintain.
Excellent. So, but
stormwater.
You know, trying to depreciate, you know, taking funds from one source and using the funds that are available.
So you're absolutely right.
Right.
And one of the things that I've seen both both Mark and Johnny work on is, so right now in St. Andrews in the historic part, we've got a parking lot that they've designed to not only be paved, but underneath is stormwater retention. I know the Harrison Avenue project also has some stormwater retention associated with it. And so it is all options on the table because it's gonna take that much effort to be able to address, you know, particularly when we get this much rain. I mean, there's a lot of things to happen, and even these people that are getting their homes bought out now, although I know all of us would rather they be able to stay there, the plan, and we took action, I think, 2 weeks ago, mm-hmm. to start the planning for a retention area there to expand it, which it once was a lake, and we are going to be returning it back to its former condition. You're right. So all options are on the table.
Okay, do I hear a motion? We need a motion on for the homeowner assistance.
Yeah, the one that expires on October 22, right?
On item 9C, that was for information purposes.
Okay, so there's no action taken. So staff recommends.
Okay. Right.
Mm-hmm. All right, we'll move on to 9D.
So item 9D is consideration to approve the purchasing manual and purchasing policy and procedures manual and adopt the resolution 2021-1012.2 effective October 1st, 2021. As background information, the City of Panama City is comprised of a number of departments and hundreds of employees who strive daily to serve the citizens of Panama City. All employees of the city have a responsibility to be found to be good stewards of the funds entrusted in their departments and to the city. With this in mind, the city attempts to codify best practices through the use of the Purchasing Policy and Procedures Manual, known as the Purchasing Manual, and to assign responsibilities and accountability in an effort to achieve transparency, audit readiness, and audit worthiness each and every day. As the city manager, I have the responsibility to ensure the proper program, procedures, and processes are in place to execute the policies that are set forth in this document. Through the logistics department, the city has identified the purchasing division as the agency responsible for the oversight of and coordination for the city's central purchasing system. The central purchasing system promotes efficiency, economy, and fair and open competition to reduce the appearance of an opportunity for favoritism and impropriety, and to promote public confidence that the purchase orders and contracts that are awarded are equitably and economically done. It is essential for effective and ethical purchases and procurement that there be a system of uniform procedures utilized by all personnel within the city that establishes basic guidelines and procedures which regulate procurement activities, contract management, and the resulting distribution of our funds. With that in mind, our staff recommends approval of resolution number 2021-1012.2. replacing any existing previous versions of the purchasing policy and procedures manual, with one exception, and that is that we must continue to operate under our FEMA recovery efforts with the existing purchasing manual that's in place, that was in place as of the date of the storm, and we will continue to do that for all of our PMO projects. And then secondly, as you know, with Triumph, the award of the Triumph grant to support the Eastern shipbuilding activity, this commission adopted the county commissioner's purchasing manual to be in line with what Triumph executes in support of the Eastern project. But for those two exceptions, this new manual will go in effect effective the 1st of October of this year.
Your motion on the purchasing policy?
Yes, Mr. Mayor, I'd like to make a motion that we approve.
And second?
I'll second.
Discussion? Call the roll.
Commissioner Halagus?
Yes.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Street?
Yes.
Mayor Brudnicki?
Yes.
Motion passes 5-0.
Mark, I just want to ask a question. This was the first update in 25 years, wasn't it? So, great work, guys. First update.
No, Mr. Zimmerman will now read the resolution.
Read the resolution.
Yes. Resolution number 2021-012.2 has been adopted. A resolution of the City Commission of the City of Panama City declaring a new purchasing policy and procedures manual to be adopted and modifying its policy and procedure manuals to include the new purchasing manual, which will replace any previous versions.
Item 9E is approval of the conceptual plan for Sweet Bay Phase 3. As background information, the project is located to the west of Sweet Bay Phase 1. Between Discovery Loop North and Frankfort Avenue. You will note that the city has previously issued a development order for the Clayton Cottages project, which will be redesigned and permitted during this project. The subdivision consists of approximately 252 residential units with all supporting infrastructure. It is anticipated that the subdivision will be platted in three sub-phases. This item was reviewed by the Planning Board on September 13, 2021, and the Planning Board recommended approval unanimously. With that, we recommend that approving the Sweet Bay Phase 3 conceptual site plan.
Your motion?
Yes, sir. I'd like to move approval of the conceptual site plan for Sweet Bay, and that's the PUD, Planned Unit Development.
Your second?
I'll second the motion, Mayor.
Discussion. Call the roll.
Commissioner Halagus?
Yes.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Street?
Yes.
Mayor Brudnicki?
Yes.
Motion passes 5-0.
With that, item 9F is the approval of Sweet Bay Phase 2C, the preliminary plat. As background information, in February of 2014, the City of Panama City approved a preliminary plat and development order to install infrastructure for its subdivision. St. Andrews Bay Land Company now submits that plat for Phase 2C of the Sweet Bay subdivision for approval and acceptance by the city. This item was reviewed by the Planning Board on September 13, 2021. The Planning Board recommended approval unanimously. As such, the staff recommends approval of the plat for Phase 2C of the preliminary plat for Sweet Bay.
Your motion?
So moved, Mayor. I'd like to move staff recommendation to approve it.
Your second?
Second motion, Mayor.
Discussion. Call the roll.
Commissioner Halagus?
Yes.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Street?
Yes.
Mayor Brudnicki?
Yes.
Motion passes 5-0.
Item 9G is approval of the Horizon Point preliminary plat. As background information, in May of 2021, the City of Panama City approved an annexation to create more housing. Brian Knox now submits the plat for Horizon Point for both approval and acceptance by the city. This item was reviewed by the Planning Board on September 13, 2021, and the Planning Board recommended approval unanimously. With that, the staff recommends approval of the Horizon Point preliminary plat.
Your motion to approve the plat for Horizon Point?
Yes, Mayor, I'll go ahead and make that motion.
Your second?
I'll second Commissioner Brown's motion.
Discussion? Call the roll.
Commissioner Halagus?
Yes.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Street?
Yes.
Mayor Budnicki?
Yes.
Motion passes 5-0.
Item 9H is consideration of approval of barge design for Part 2 Architectural and Engineering Services in the amount of $272,900 for Daffin Park only, which is a FEMA project number 82367. As background information, the city advertised a request for qualification on June 11, 2021, and received three responses from qualified architectural firms on July 9, 2021. After careful consideration of the qualified firms, Barge Design was recommended as the best qualified, and the city manager was successfully negotiated an acceptable fee for their services. The Daffin project is now successfully starting their phase two detailed project program based on a determined cost of work budget. With that in mind, the department recommends approval of this contract with Barge Design.
I'll let the rest of the commission know I spent quite a bit of time on this during the week, and we're looking for at least three or four other sources to resource this project so that, and in order to be able to get those funds, all this work needs to be completed. So kind of a necessary evil, but I'm hopeful that we are going to be able to resource much more than the amount we're getting from FEMA.
Well, and I will move a motion to approve, but I do want to, because it was a little bit of confusion last time, and I just want to kind of, what I learned as well through that process is, so we had two community meetings, okay? We had community input of what the citizens want to see at Daffin Park. A kind of soft analysis of that after all of that came together was about a $5 million project. We only have about $750,000 of FEMA dollars, but it doesn't mean that we just put back what we had. We've talked about being better than we were. And so this next step is to pay, and I mean, I was looking at how detailed this stuff is. I mean, it's not just like, you know, have walking trail, playground, of course, pedestrian walkways, but everything, they've got to figure out everything from plant location to trash receptacles to irrigation to the engineering and the grading. I mean, it's very detailed stuff, but it will be, when this is done, then it comes to us and the city staff, we're long gone, right? And the citizens have said, this is what we want. Now we get this back from them and we can get phase one, phase two, and then we'll figure out every budget year how to do. I mean, this included a splash pad. And I mean, it was a dream of what the citizens want. And so it may take us 5 to 7 to 10 years to complete it, depending on the phases. But the only way to be shovel ready is to get this done. And so I just want to make sure that I was confused about that last time. And Mark made a good point, reminded me, do you want to just be the way we always have been? Or do you want to, you know, do you want to do what they want? And I was like, well, I want to do what they want, but it just kind of scared me through all that. And we're going to face this with all the parks that we have. This isn't going to be a quick turnaround. You're going to have a shining star in a year. But this will give us a logical way to implement the plan that the citizens want in phase by phase, year by year. So I just wanted to clarify that's what this is.
Good explanation.
Yeah, and I think the wisdom that's behind it is we are taking the feedback that's coming from the communities and we are putting them into plans and actions. Can we do that in year one? Some of this we may not be able to do for 20 years. But we're at least taking the feedback that's coming from the communities and we're putting it into a plan, and then we'll start to take it chunk by chunk. I know we've got another item that's coming up that's going to be in a similar case. Our dream is bigger than what our financial resources are able to achieve, mm-hmm. but that doesn't mean that we don't keep taking action that our citizens are asking us to take. So I understand. Thank you for the additional clarity that you provide.
And this is going to be with every FEMA project we have. We're going to have, I mean, unless it's just an in-house, you know, put something back. But I did want to reiterate, though, that you did say that, you know, getting the fields back up and going, the basics of that irrigation, sod, lighting is important. That's correct. We know that'll be in phase one.
That's right.
I just wanted to reiterate that to the people. So, okay. That's all I have.
Fair second?
Second the motion.
Okay, under discussion, call the roll.
Commissioner Halagus?
Yes.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Street?
Yes.
Mayor Budnicki?
Yes.
Motion passes 5-0.
So to your point, Commissioner, I draw your attention to item 9I, which is the consideration to reject the bids associated with the City of Panama City project number 13034-B, which is the Carl Gray Park Phase 2 improvements. As background information, five bids were received for this project with the low bid at $3,306,044, amounting to $2,632,180.44 over our budget. With that in mind, we recommend that we reject all bids and rebid the project with a revised scope of work for a phase one bid, which would be the western half of the project, and then a phase two bid for the eastern half of the project at a later time when funding is secured. And that would be advertised at a later date when additional funding does become available. And so it would just a crawl, walk, run methodology.
Mark, would it be fair for me to say that going forward, we'll be able to break up every construction project into phases so that we don't get into that same situation?
Right.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So basically, next go around, we'll have a more realistic budget of what we can't afford, and that's what'll go out. Because what I don't want to have everybody spend time to do contracts and things like that, and then we can't execute it. But you know, obviously, we can't go $2.6 million over budget. Although you guys could forget everything that I just said on this last comment, and we could just go ahead and motion to approve it. That's fine. But I think the reasonable thing would be to break this up into phases, and I agree with that. I know we're going to work on potentially a partnership with the trolley system on bathrooms, and so we've got a couple things that we've got in the works. Maybe we can even look at Gulf Power on lighting, too, and hopefully find some good partnerships to get something done there. So,
motion to reject.
I'll make the motion to reject.
I'll second the motion to reject all bids.
Any other discussion? Call the roll.
Commissioner Halagus?
Yes.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Street?
Yes.
Mayor Budnicki?
Yes.
Motion to reject passes 5-0.
Mark, do you know when this will come back to us for phase one?
Well, it'll go back out for revised construction documents. We anticipate that in the next month that we'll have that back.
Okay.
And then we'll put that out for bid and then bring back the phase one proposals to you.
So maybe we'll have something by the end of December. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yes, okay. Sir.
Really quick, just to Josh's point, though, like the people who did, I mean, it's a lot of work to
it's
put
a lot
in
of
that.
Work.
Will we
yeah.
give
mm-hmm.
the courtesy of calling them, letting
yes.
them know, and
mm-hmm.
all that? Okay.
Right.
And let them know what we'll do in the future.
That's true. And they were great companies that all bid, and they're very strong. But it was just construction costs have wildly increased since the time that FEMA approved dollars for this.
So please keep bidding. That's what I would communicate to
right.
those contractors. We need your help to rebuild the city. And so and we've learned a lot through this process, and we'll improve it.
All right. With that, I move your attention to item 9J, which is regarding our Triumph programming. Consideration of approval of change order number 2 of the phase 1 uphill bulkhead project to H.G. Harders and Sons in the amount of $2,090,650 in accordance with the change order number 2, which was approved and recommended by DRMP, which is the CEI service for the City of Panama City. This change order is incorporated into the Triumph Gulf Coast Grant. The City of Panama City entered into the grant award agreement with Triumph Gulf Coast and Eastern Shipbuilding on August 1st, 2019. This grant is to provide funding for the infrastructure improvements, including the platens, the dredging, the bulkhead installations, launchways, equipment, and warehouse facilities on an easement owned by the city. This in accordance with a previous agenda item dated 1/19/21, the city approved a contract and scope which was vetted by DRMP for Harters to provide the initial Phase 1 uphill bulkhead project. Further, in accordance with the City Commission action on September 27th, 2021, change order number one in the amount of $859,274,000 was also vetted by DRMP and was approved for the Phase 1 uphill bulkhead project. In accordance with the attached DRMP documents, approves this change order number two for Harters to provide the additional Phase 1 uphill bulkhead scope of work. With that, it's our recommendation that we award that change order number two to H.G. Harters and Sons Incorporated.
Motion?
Yes, I'd like to move approval of this.
Your second?
Okay.
And it is Triumph Funds.
I'll second the motion.
Yes.
It's not the city. We're just, yeah.
Actually,
call the roll.
The next three, right?
Commissioner Halagus?
Yes.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Street?
Yes.
Mayor Bernicke?
Yes.
Motion passes 5-0.
Mark, can I ask a quick question?
Sure.
So on these, you know, the reimbursements, about how long does it typically take us to get reimbursed?
Takes a while because it goes back up to the state and the Triumph auditors go through each one of those invoices. We have our auditing company also going through those prior to, but it just takes a while for their process to do those reimbursements.
And I'm assuming we have enough cash on hand because these are big numbers.
These are big numbers.
So, okay.
All right. Mm-hmm. Okay. All right. Moving on to item 9K, which is consideration of approval of change order number three for the Phase 1 uphill bulkhead project to H.G. Harters and Sons in the amount of $257,350 in accordance with change order number three, which is approved and recommended by DRMP. This change order is incorporated into the Triumph Gulf Coast grant. As background information, it's the same as I shared with you before. However, I would like to add that in accordance with the previous agenda item, that was dated on January 19, 2021, and the city purchase order 2021-00000888. The city approved a contract and scope vetted by DRMP for Harters to provide the initial Phase 1 uphill bulkhead project. In accordance with the attached, DRMP approves this change order number three for Harters to provide pier demolition in conjunction with the Phase 1 uphill bulkhead scope of work. With that, it's my recommendation that we move forward with change order number three to H.G. Harters in the amount of $257,350 to support the Triumph Gulf Coast project at Eastern Shipbuilding.
Your motion?
Move a motion.
Second motion, Mayor.
Discussion. Call the roll.
Commissioner Halagus?
Yes.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Street?
Yes.
Mayor Bernicke?
Yes.
Motion passes 5-0.
That's count for the next one too.
Where
you L? This is the last one.
That's a good question. Do we have to do them all separately, or can we do them all in?
This one, yeah. Okay. We
have to. Okay.
Okay.
All right. The next item is item 9L, which is consideration of approval of change order number three for the fin stabilizer dredge project to Diamond Services Corporation in the amount of $2,706,600. In accordance with change order number three, approved and recommended by DRMP, this change order is incorporated into the Triumph Gulf Coast grant. It's the same information as I shared earlier as background information, but in addition to that, in accordance with a previous agenda item, which was dated July 7th, 2021, the city approved a contract and scope vetted by DRMP for Diamond to provide the initial fin stabilizer dredge project. Further, in accordance with the City Commission action on September 27, 2021, change order number two in the amount of $134,000 was also vetted by DRMP and was approved for the fin stabilizer dredge project. In accordance with the attached, DRMP approves this change order number three for Diamond Services to provide the additional dredging scope of work. With that in mind, recommend change order number three be adopted by this commission in the amount of $2,706,600 to Diamond Services Corporation.
Motion on 9L.
Yes. Well, usually we, I don't mean to be rude, but Mayor, don't we have a motion, a second, then we have discussion?
Yeah, so he had motion,
yeah.
Second?
Yes, and then
Okay, discussion?
Did you make, I'm sorry. I thought I heard you make.
Process of making the motion.
So I'd like to second his motion, then we can have a discussion.
Okay.
Yes.
You want to address us on this?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Again, Walter P. Henry, 614 Mayfair Avenue, Panama City, Florida. I'd like to know where all these bookheads and these projects are. I never like change orders. The city don't like them either, but you get stuck with them after you done got somebody to do a job, then they come back and supposed to be done looked over and find out what anything need to be done. And I know somehow they just how these change orders come by. And then they price you up because you're knowing that nobody else, you're not gonna get nobody else to do it, and they ain't gonna let nobody else come in there to do it because y'all paying them to do it. And they just set these prices up. But where is this happening?
Eastern Shipbuilding.
Eastern Shipbuilding. And Triumph is paying for all of this.
Yeah, it's all in Millville.
Eastern Shipbuilding is paying for it?
Yes.
BP Oil is paying for all, but the city's not.
Through the Triumph.
And that's a great question, Pastor Henry.
Everybody hates change orders.
But these specifically are not change orders to the original work order. These are expansion. They're now doing additional dredging that was not in the original proposal. So at the same cost of what they won the first bid with. So these are good prices, put it with that. And it's an expansion of the work, not the same work that was bid in the original bid.
Well, that's an excellent point.
Yeah, I understand it. Because when you say change orders, it's not an add. Instead of just saying an add.
Expansion. It's an expanded.
Expansion of the work.
They're doing more dredging than they were going to do.
Instead of a change order, you're adding something to the project.
That's correct.
That's what I'm saying. You get folks understanding. It's not really a change order.
Yeah. Thank you, Mr. Henry.
Thank you.
Okay. We have motion and second. Call the roll.
Commissioner Halagus?
Yes.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Street?
Yes.
Mayor Bernicki?
Yes.
Motion passes 5-0.
Item 9M is consideration to approve proposals from DRMP in the amount of $186,233.33 for additional CEI services associated with the Triumph Gulf Coast Grant, Phase 1 uphill bulkhead and fin stabilizer dredge projects. The costs associated with these additional CEI services are 100% reimbursable to the City of Panama City in accordance with the Triumph Gulf Coast Grant. As background information, in accordance with the a previous agenda item dated December 1st, 2020, the city approved a continuing services contract in the amount of $182,251 for DRMP to provide the CEI services associated with the Triumph Gulf Coast Grant, Phase 1 uphill bulkhead scope of work. In accordance with the attached DRMP, we'll provide additional CEI services associated with the Phase 1 uphill bulkhead change orders number 1, 2, and 3 to HGR Orders and Sons, and B, fin stabilizer dredge project change orders number 2 and 3 to Diamond Services Corporation. With that, it's recommended that we move forward with this change order to award $186,233.33 to support the CEI services.
Your motion on 9M?
I'll make a motion.
Second motion, Mayor.
Discussion? Call the roll.
Commissioner Halagus?
Yes.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Street?
Yes.
Mayor Bernicki?
Yes.
Motion passes 5-0.
Item 9N is the consideration for the purchase and budget amendment resolution 2021-1012.1 for the purchase of 4 all-terrain vehicles and 1 cargo trailer from the state forfeiture funds in the amount of $40,500. It's our recommendation that we move forward with this purchase.
Your motion?
Yes, Mayor, I'd like to move staff recommendation on item 9N.
Second motion, Mayor.
Discussion. Call the roll.
Commissioner Halagus?
Yes.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes, ma'am.
Commissioner Street?
Yes.
Mayor Bernicki?
Yes.
Motion passes 5-0.
Item 9-0, I'm going to, correction, go ahead and you want to do the resolution?
Thank you.
Do I have a resolution?
Yes.
I apologize. Does somebody have it?
Yes, I do.
Is there a resolution attached? Did we, we're on 9N.
N.
I don't have a resolution in my packet.
Maybe it's not stapled in?
Did not get included in that.
Did we require a resolution for the state forfeiture?
Randy, do we need a resolution?
Do we need a resolution?
Okay, well, let's have a resolution.
I don't think it was included in our packet.
What number would it be?
It's on your agenda.
Okay, 2021, 1012.1. Okay. Let me read it here in just a minute. It'll take just a second.
Here it is in there.
Yeah, I don't have one in my pocket.
I'm going to find it here in just a second.
I don't think it's in my pocket.
Find it.
That's just the title. Yeah, I know. That's just the title.
Resolution number 2021-1012.1. The City Commission of Panama City, Florida adopts a resolution approving the purchase of 4 Polaris Sportsmen and utilizing the state forfeiture funds.
Way to pull it out.
Great. Thank you. With that, I'm going to move into item 9O, which is a public hearing for the First Amendment to the Massalina Holdings Development Agreement. In your packet, you'll see a letter from our city attorney with regard to this. This is a public hearing for the First Amendment, and Mr. Zimmerman, would you like to make the presentation?
Thank you. This is a public hearing. There will be no action at this meeting. There will be a second public hearing to consider the First Amendment to the Massalina Holdings Development Agreement on October 26, 2021. At that time, the developer will be asking the City Commission to approve the amendments. The primary changes to the development agreement, and this is a parcel of property. Historically, it was known as Tibbetts Marina, and then it was called Massalina Holdings when it was purchased a few years ago. And now the new owner, it'll be called Pelican Pass Condominiums, LLC. And the proposal is to change the name on the development agreement to reflect the new owner, increase the number of condominium units from 48 units to 60. This is still within the zoning that's which is an allowable density. Also, the total number of wet slips of 49 remain unchanged, but they will be connected to the condominium and there will not be a commercial marina. And there is more information that's attached. And with that, Mayor, this is a public hearing for any comments.
Comments from the public? Okay, seeing no one, we'll vote on this in 2 weeks.
That's correct.
Thank you.
Okay, item 9P is consideration and approval of a memorandum of understanding between the Public Works Utilities and Project Management Office and the Community Development CRA to perform services with the use of any CDBG related funds to include CDBG, CDBGDR, and CDBG CV. With that in mind, in accordance with HUD CDBG regulations 24 CFR 570.503, recipients of CDBG funds are required to have written agreements, contracts, or MOUs in effect before dispersing any of the funds provided by CDBG. The written agreement, contract, or MOU must remain in effect during any period that the subrecipient and recipient has control over any CDBG funds, including program income. Services can include environmental reviews, revitalization, and infrastructure project improvements. With that in mind, our staff recommends approval for the MOU that is presented for your consideration.
We have a motion on 9P.
Yes, I move staff, staff recommends approval, sorry.
Second motion, Mayor.
Discussion, call the roll.
Commissioner Halagus.
Yes.
Commissioner Brown.
Yes.
Commissioner Rader.
Yes.
Commissioner Street.
Yes.
Mayor Bernicki.
Yes.
Motion passes 5-0.
Item 9Q is an update in the additional engineering for Snug Harbor Boat Ramp. As background information, the Quality of Life Department is moving forward with Snug Harbor Boat Ramp Project. This will include updating the design documents to include restrooms and the CEI services. The total proposed fee will not exceed $47,640 and will be executed by Panhandle Engineering. With that in mind, it's a recommendation that we move forward with a task order to Panhandle Engineering in the amount of $47,640 for the updated design for Snug Harbor Boat Ramp.
Your motion on 9Q?
Obviously, I'm going to move a motion.
Second
yes.
motion.
Any other discussion? Call a roll.
Well, real quick, I just want to make sure everybody knows it's because we'd already done engineering before, but it didn't include restrooms. So I know you said it, but right. I just want to reiterate that this is, it just wasn't as great as it could have been. Not that they didn't do a great job back then, but that it's going to include adding a restroom facility, a grinder lift station, revising the parking lot layout to accommodate, relocating the dumpster. And one of the biggest things, it had no landscaping
That's
before.
Right.
So now it will have, you know, landscape design, irrigation, and all that. So I just want to make sure everybody knew that's going to.
And a freshwater washdown.
That's
fresh
right. That's down. Included. Yeah. It is.
Call roll.
Commissioner Halagus.
Yes.
Commissioner Brown.
Yes.
Commissioner Rader.
Yes.
Commissioner Street.
Yes.
Mayor Bernicki.
Yes.
Motion passes 5-0.
Amen. Item 9R is consideration of approval of a resolution to allow the temporary closure of 14th Street for an FDOT project. As background information, Gorda Moeller Engineering Incorporated is working with FDOT on a project to improve the drainage and reduce flooding near 1349 Harrison Avenue. In order to improve the drainage along this system that ultimately outfalls to the Massalina Bayou, FDOT is adding a new pipe crossing the 14th Street. As you may be aware, there is a history of structural flooding at 1349 Harrison Avenue. Based on FDOT's evaluation, as well as Gorda Moeller's drainage improvements are required along this system. In order to improve the conditions within the FDOT right-of-way at 14th and Harrison, Gorda Moeller has proposed a new 36-inch pipe in the storm drain system as part of this project. The city will still need to make improvements upstream and or downstream to completely resolve the drainage issues within this system. This project is scheduled to finish in March of 2022. With that in mind, it's our recommendation that we move forward with the staff recommendation, which is authorize FDOT to close the 14th Street and Harrison intersection to allow the Public Works to do the necessary work with FDOT to do that replacement of that pipe.
Motion on 9R.
Yes, Mr. Mayor, I'd like a motion to approve.
I'll second, but I have a question for Mr. McQueen. As we know, 14th Street, we've talked about that before, and there are some companies there that have great big trucks coming in and out that have to make deliveries. So will they be affected if they come in from the eastern, I mean the western section?
There actually should be pretty minimal impact because okay. we will be maintaining some flow of traffic, particularly Monday through Friday, 8 to 5.
Okay.
So it should be have minimal impact to any of those businesses in the area. But it is something that is necessary that we do.
Yep.
I
realize FDOT, you know,
right.
they trump us mm-hmm. on this.
Yep.
So but it's important to do as part of it, yeah. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Call the roll.
Commissioner Halagus?
Yes.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Street?
Yes.
Mayor Bernicki?
Yes.
Motion passes 5-0.
Commission has adopted Resolution 2021-10-12.3, a resolution of the City Commission of the City to approve a temporary road closure pursuant to completion of drainage improvements at 14th Street and SR 75 Harrison Avenue by FDOT.
With that in mind, moving on to 9S, which is consideration of approval for the professional services for Panama City SRF projects for the general engineers. As background information, the Public Works Department solicited qualifications from experienced and qualified architects and or engineers to provide professional services for the design and engineering for repair, replacement, or remediation of stormwater systems, water and sanitary sewer systems, wastewater and wastewater treatment, and roadway and pavement systems. The RFQ was issued pursuant to Section 287.055 of the Florida statutes, which is known as the Consultants Competitive Negotiation Act. Firms to be considered for your approval are detailed in the attached documentation, and the staff recommends that another RFQ issued for other SRF general engineers to be going out with an open window for the next two-year period for any additional SRF general engineers which may be required. With that in mind, it's our recommendation that you move forward with the adoption of the recommended engineers.
Your motion?
I'll make a motion.
Second.
Discussion? Call the roll.
Commissioner Halagus?
Yes.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Street?
Yes.
Mayor Bernicki?
Yes.
Motion passes 5-0.
To be clear, those that have just been approved will not need to be to recompete. We're just opening the window for the next two-year time frame so that as other engineering firms decide to do work here in the city of Panama City, there's an open window for them to put their qualifications forward for consideration.
Right. They've already been qualified.
Correct.
These here have already been qualified. We're just continuing to keep the window open for the next 2 years for them, for other engineering firms that may want to be considered for work with the city.
Gotcha.
Okay. And as projects are identified within this parameter of SRF, and contracts are proposed, then those will come back to the city.
Sure. I like to see that we've really opened it up. When we first started doing the continuing contract, it was kind of a small group. Mm-hmm. Especially after the storm, we needed a lot more help. And then it was time consuming trying to get. So it's nice to see we have, and there's like 39 qualified and from all over. So it's great. Mm-hmm. Thanks.
Thank you. With that, I invite your attention to 9T, which
that's
is
the 39. Sorry.
Yeah, that's right. Which is consideration of approval of a continuing professional services contract for the engineering and architects and the Public Works Department solicited proposals from experienced and qualified architects and engineers to provide continuing professional services for the City of Panama City. The scope of the project included provisions of the city to solicit task orders for future projects from the chosen consultant list. The RFQ was issued pursuant to Section 287.055. of the Florida statutes, which is known as the Consultants Competitive Negotiation Act. Firms to be considered for your approval are detailed in the attachment, and staff recommends, again, that another RFQ be issued for the continuing professional services with an open window for the next 2 years in the event additional continuing professional services for engineer and architectural services are required. With that, it's our recommendation that you approve the attached engineering list.
Motion on 9T.
Yes, Mayor, I'd like the motion to approve.
I'll second that, and it looks like we have no shortage of engineers.
We got a bunch.
We need a bunch of them on there.
Call the roll.
Commissioner Halagus?
Yes.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Street?
Yes.
Mayor Bernicki?
So yes.
Does that mean that projects will be engineered quicker? With all these, I mean,
issue task orders.
Yes, task orders. That's right. Okay.
Thank you. Sorry to interrupt you.
Sorry. With that, we move forward on item 9U, which is consideration of approval for professional services for Panama City SRF projects lead engineers. The Public Works Department solicited qualifications from experienced and qualified architects and or engineers with SRF experience to provide professional services for the design and engineering for the repair, replacement, and remediation of stormwater systems, water and sanitary sewer systems, wastewater and wastewater treatment, as well as roadway and pavement systems. The RFQ was issued pursuant to Section 287.055 of the Florida statutes known as the Consultants Competitive Negotiation Act. Firms to be considered for your approval are detailed as the attached, which would be Mott McDonald Florida LLC and Panhandle Engineering Incorporated. And these two firms will be our lead engineers with regard to the state revolving fund projects.
Your motion on 9U?
I'll make a motion. I would like to ask a question.
But I'll second first.
Perfect. Mark, you kind of know, like, this is like a big step for us.
Huge.
This is the start of all the engineering through major zones in the city. Do you kind of have an idea on timelines now? I know we can give these two guys 30 days, I think, to get everything done. and so we can start construction. No, I'm just kidding. I wish. So, what are kind of your thoughts on timeline and how we'll attack this?
So these two engineering firms will be the lead engineers with regard to the state revolving fund. They'll help to manage the modeling that will take place. They'll help to manage all of the documentation associated with the state revolving fund. Of course, this commission took action 2 weeks ago to accept the final documentation from DEP with regard to the state revolving fund, which is the $113 million, which is for sanitary sewer as well as potable water systems. What you did on item 9S was to, let me backtrack. These two are going to be managing the total program for the city as well as all of the submissions by our other engineers that you approved just a few moments ago. Those engineers will be task ordered to each of those areas that we identified in the heat map that was presented a number of months ago to the commission, saying this is why we needed to have the state revolving fund. We see that these other engineers that you approved on 9S, which there were about 15 of them, that they will be assigned different areas and they'll begin design. When they submit their designs, it'll go through these two engineering firms, one or the other, for review and inclusion into the modeling to make sure that everything is appropriate for the total system that we're trying to rebuild.
And so...
kind of like a check.
So now the task orders...
It's a great system.
And the task orders will go out. Some are small areas, some are very large areas, so I can't give you a date certain for each of those. But I can tell you that we have very capable and competent engineers, and I will tell you that they will work diligently to get this done.
I have no doubt.
And then once we get those back, since we have more requirements than we have funding, we have to go and, again, to your point earlier, is having shovel-ready projects for other monies that become available, whether it's CDBGDR funding or whether it's infrastructure dollars that come available either through the federal or state government that will help us to be ready to deploy those funds when they become available.
Do you know about when we should expect to see some shovel projects with specifically SRF stuff going?
I would hope to see that sometime in the spring, that we'd start seeing some of those projects. There are some that are already in engineering that are not SRF specific. Mm-hmm. Some are a portion of them. For example, Cherry Street is a portion of the state revolving fund that may be eligible for that. I expect by the spring of next year, we'll start seeing a number of projects across the city moving forward. This is also complementary to the CDBGDR, the $19 million that the governor awarded for Millville. So this is all part and parcel to our efforts to rebuild the infrastructure of the city.
And not that Mark can't speak for himself, but just to clarify, that's great because we haven't been able to do the engineering for that $19 million because just like the sub-agreement, mm-hmm. a sub-recipient agreement that
that's
we
right.
have done with the voluntary buyout, like we don't have the money to do it until we sign that sub-recipient agreement, right? But anyway.
That's right. We still don't know when we're going to get the money.
Right, because like you said, even the voluntary buyout, that was 9 months later.
That's right.
Right, yeah. Just the agreement. But I just want to clarify what you're saying, I think, is that we know we're around 300 plus million for the infrastructure that will only cover that we've got funding tied to from all different places, right? And that is only from what I know from Johnny, that's only about 50% of what the city really needs. It's just the highest, the most critical versus
that's right.
the other, although it's all critical probably.
That's right.
But what you're saying is we're going to go ahead and do the task order for everything that we need mm-hmm. so that when we have another opportunity from DEO or something like that and we don't have one of the projects that's in the 50% that's covered, we say, hey, look, we're ready for that grant because mm-hmm. we've got all the engineering done. We are ready to rock and roll, and
that's
we'll
right.
have a better opportunity mm-hmm. maybe to win those
that's
win
right.
those grants.
That's right.
Okay.
And you may remember about 6 or 8 weeks ago, we only received the first half of the first allocation of dollars from DEP with regard to the state revolving fund. That was the $79 million of which they allowed us to begin and proceed with $19 million allocated for all of the engineering services that are needed. So that's what we're starting to draw off of at this point.
When will we know when we'll have the construction money available? Like we're doing the engineering now.
So some of that $79 million was construction dollars.
Okay.
And then the other, as you took action 2 weeks ago, that was for the sanitary sewer part of it, and they only gave 2/3 of that money, $29 million of the $39 million.
That's right.
And
enough to get us started.
Enough to get us started, right.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Good deal.
I would just point out that, you know, I know it's a very frustrating situation for a lot of people, but, you know, you're looking at the staff and the commission. I mean, the longest that we've had in the last, I'd say, 90 days between when we get the documents to action is 2 weeks. Mm-hmm. So, and even with the voluntary home buyout, we were immediately able to take action on the appraiser because we'd already selected him. So I think we'll start to see a lot faster movement. But, you know, once we get them, it's not very far before we take significant action. Right. So,
and this is also inclusive of the funding that the state provided, for example, Lift Station 16, mm-hmm. The septic to sewer transition program, the study for the movement of the Millville wastewater treatment plant. Our engineers that have been vetted and approved through this process will be able to help us with all of those efforts.
Excellent.
Okay, we have a motion and second.
I think we do.
Yep. Yes.
Call the roll.
Commissioner Halagus?
Yes.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Street?
Yes.
Mayor Brunicki?
Yes, ma'am.
Motion passes 5-0.
Okay. Invite your attention to item 10A, which is the first reading of Ordinance 3023.1, amending the future land use map of the city to reflect a land use designation and mixed use for the property located at 700 West 11th Street. As background information, the applicant is requesting a land use change and a rezoning in order to utilize the lot for employee parking. This item was reviewed by the Planning Board on September 13, 2021, and the Planning Board recommended approval unanimously. As such, it's recommended that we conduct the first reading of the ordinance.
First reading, Ordinance 3023.1, an ordinance amending the comprehensive plan future land use map of the city to reflect a land use designation of mixed use for a parcel of property located at 700 West 11th Street, Panama City, providing for repealer, severability, and effective date.
Item 10B is first reading of Ordinance 3023.2, amending the zoning map of the city to reflect a zoning designation of mixed use 3, MU3, for the property located at 700 West 11th Street. It's the same information as I shared earlier in the future land use agenda request, and as such, the recommendation is to conduct the first reading of the ordinance.
First reading, Ordinance 3023.2, an ordinance zoning a parcel of property located at 700 West 11th Street, Panama City, having approximately 0.28 acres, mixed use 3, providing for severability and effective date.
Item 10C is first reading of Ordinance 3026.1, the voluntary annexation of 0.62 acres of property located at 2240 West 24th Street in Panama City, Florida. The applicant has requested annexation into the city in order to access city utilities. This item was reviewed by the Planning Board on September 13, 2021, and is recommended approval unanimously. As such, the recommendation is to conduct the first reading of the request for annexation.
First reading, Ordinance 3026.1, an ordinance of the city approving the voluntary annexation of 0.62 acres of unincorporated property located at 2240 West 24th Street, Bay County, Florida, into the city as further defined hereinafter, amending the wards and boundaries of the city to include the land.
Item 10D is the first reading of Ordinance 3026.2, amending the future land use map of the city to reflect a land use designation of general commercial for the property located at 2240 West 24th Street. As background information, it's the same as I shared in the annexation agenda request, and the recommendation is to conduct the first reading of the ordinance.
First reading, Ordinance 3026.2. An ordinance amending the comprehensive plan future land use map of the city to reflect the land use designation of general commercial for a parcel of property located at 2240 West 24th Street, providing for repealer, severability, effective date.
Item 10E is first reading of Ordinance 3026.3, amending the zoning map of the city to reflect a zoning designation of general commercial 2, GC2, for the property located at 2240 West 24th Street. His background information is the same as I shared during the annexation amendment agenda request, and the recommendation is to conduct the first reading of the ordinance.
First reading of ordinance 3026.3, an ordinance zoning a parcel of property located at 2240 West 24th Street, Panama City, Florida, having approximately 0.62 acres, GC2, providing for severability and effective date.
Mr. Mayor?
I've got an addendum we need to add.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
It's item 10, it will be item 10F, not 11A. It'll be 10F.
Okay, item 10F, motion to add.
I'll make a motion.
Item 10F.
I'll second the motion.
Call the roll.
Commissioner Halagus?
Yes.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Street?
Yes.
Mayor Bernicki?
Yes.
Motion passes 5-0.
Item 10F is the consideration of approval of Kuina Grundehofer Architects for the Part II Architectural and Engineering Services in the amount of $464,496 for the overall master plan design and all construction documents for the St. Andrews Cultural Center facility known as the St. Andrews Elementary School. As background information, the city advertised a request for qualification on July 2nd, 2021 and received 4 responses for qualified architectural firms on July 21st, 2021. After careful consideration of the qualified firm, Kuina Grundehofer Architects was recommended as the best qualified, and the city manager, myself, has successfully negotiated an acceptable fee for their services. QG Architects is now preparing the overall master plan design for the St. Andrews Cultural Center, known as the St. Andrews School, incorporating Architects Part II detailed project program based on the defined cost of work budget. As such, it's our recommendation that we move forward with the award of this contract to Kuina Grundehofer Architects in the amount of $464,496.
Motion.
Motion.
Second.
Discussion. Call the roll.
Commissioner Halagus?
Yes.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Street?
Yes.
Mayor Bernicki?
Yes.
Motion passes 5-0.
This was the same situation as Daffin. I just wanted to point that out.
And it's the same master plan.
Yep.
Okay. That's all I have.
All right. There's nothing else to come before us. We do have a Destination Panama City meeting. Give us about 10 minutes break. Thank you. Thank you.